Well, good morning. Welcome to the Breakfast News on Rajya Sabha TV. I'm Ashwarya with you. All the biggest news stories from India and across the world coming up in the next 30 minutes. Let us start with the headlines. Ending Kashmir's special status entirely internal matter with no external ramifications, says India after UNSC closed-door meet on Jammu and Kashmir. United Nations appreciates India's steps in Jammu and Kashmir. Entire UN Security Council, barring China, backs India at the informal meeting on Jammu and Kashmir. US President Donald Trump asks Imran Khan to resolve tensions with India bilaterally, refuses to mediate between the two countries over Kashmir. Pakistan's attempt to rake up Kashmir at the UNSC falls flat. Mobile internet services are restored in five districts of Jammu and Kashmir, including Samba, Kathua and Udhampur. 12 out of 22 districts returned to normalcy. Schools, educational institutions to reopen from Monday. Prime Minister Narendra Modi leaves for a two-day visit to Bhutan. Describes India-Bhutan partnership as an important pillar of government's neighborhood-first policy. Both sides are to discuss security issues and cooperation on hydropower generation. And to solidify India's relationship with the Baltic nations, Vice President M. Venkaiah Naidu to leave on a six-day visit to Lithuania, Latvia and Estonia. Several agreements likely to be signed. The top story this morning, India on Friday said that the country's national position was and remains that matters related to Kashmir are entirely an internal matter in a rare closed-door meeting at the United Nations Security Council. The meeting was to discuss New Delhi's move to end the special status of Jammu and Kashmir. The meeting was called after Pakistan, backed by its all-weather ally China, requested close consultations on the issue. And briefing the media following the conclusion of the informal summit, India's permanent representative to the United Nations, Syed Akbaruddin, reiterated that matters related to the abrogation of Article 370 are entirely an internal matter of India and these have no external ramifications. Syed Akbaruddin said that the government is committed to gradually removing all the restrictions in Jammu and Kashmir and the government is undertaking steps towards normalcy. He also said that the recent decisions taken by India and its legislative bodies are intended to ensure that good governance is promoted, social economic development is enhanced and our people in Jammu and Kashmir and Ladakh are taken care of.
Our national position was and remains that matters related to Article 370 of the Indian Constitution are entirely an internal matter of India. These have no external ramifications. The recent decisions taken by the Government of India and our legislative bodies are intended to ensure that good governance is promoted, socio-economic development is enhanced for our people in Jammu and Kashmir and Ladakh. You are aware this morning that the Chief Secretary of the State of the Union Territory of Jammu and Kashmir announced a whole set of measures that the government is undertaking to move towards normalcy. We are gratified that the Security Council in its close consultations appreciated these efforts, acknowledged them, and indicated that this is the direction in which they would like the international community to move.
And he said that India is committed to ensuring that the situation remains calm and peaceful. Without naming Pakistan, Syed Akbaruddin said that there are some who are trying to project an alarmist approach to the situation in Kashmir, which is far from the ground realities. He asserted that there are normal diplomatic ways when countries deal with each other.
We are committed to gradually removing all restrictions. You are aware of the timetable for that. Let me also tell you, since the changes internal to India have not made any difference to our external orientation, India remains committed to ensure that the situation there remains calm and peaceful. We are committed to all the agreements that we have signed on this issue. We note that there were some who tried to project an alarmist approach to the situation, which is far from the ground realities. Of particular concern is that one state is using terminology of jihad against and promoting violence in India, including by their leaders. Friends, violence is no solution to the problems that all of us face. We are committed to and inconsistent with our previous position that all issues between India and Pakistan, as well as India and any other country, will be resolved bilaterally, peacefully, and in a manner that behoves normal interstate relations between countries. We are saddened that terrorism is being fueled, language and incendiary talk of jihad is being mentioned by people who should know better. All of you are understanding of the situation here. I do not need to tell you what was the outcome of the close consultations. You will yourself know about it. We stand ready to continue our efforts towards peaceful resolution of all issues in an atmosphere free of terror and violence.
Well, the outcome of the UNSC meeting will not be a formal pronouncement, as the consultations are informal in nature. India and Pakistan did not attend the meeting, which was open only to the 5 permanent members and 10 non-permanent members. Meanwhile, U.S. President Donald Trump has asked Pakistan Prime Minister Imran Khan to resolve tensions bilaterally on Kashmir with India. The phone conversation between Donald Trump and Imran Khan took place before the closed-door meeting of the United Nations Security Council in New York on the revocation of the special status of Jammu and Kashmir. The White House readout of the call was issued after the meeting concluded at the United Nations headquarters. Deputy Press Secretary of the country said in a statement that Donald Trump conveyed the importance of India and Pakistan reducing tensions through bilateral dialogue regarding the situation in Jammu and Kashmir. All right, let's get a perspective. Akhilesh Suman, our colleague, is now joining us on the phone line. A very good morning, Akhilesh. We saw India how calmly really navigated the UNSC meeting on Kashmir. And we also saw how Pakistan and China were isolated completely. And India reiterating very, very categorically that the constitutional changes that are made in the state are internal matter of our country.
Right, Swarya. Actually, Pakistan and China wanted to call a formal meeting of United Nations Security Council, and it needed 9 members, at least 9 members of UNSC for calling a formal meeting, and they failed. They could not garner even 2 members of United Nations Security Council. So this was an informal meeting of Security Council members. And, you know, other than China, no other country supported Pakistan and China's stand on Jammu and Kashmir and abrogation of Article 370. Even before joining the meeting, Russian ambassador to United Nations, say that it is United Nations Security Council has no business. And they have made it clear that they are not going to take up this issue again in a format that should be considered that appeasing Pakistan or China. So I think China has got a reply from all the members of Security Council, and that is why embarrassed China came out of the meeting and hold a press conference. It was not required. It was not actually expected. The informal meeting, only President of United Nations Security Council authorized to make any press release or to make any statement. But the Security Council members did not allow to make any formal statement of the informal meeting. China was embarrassed and came out and tell what they had been telling from their national perspective and from Pakistan's perspective. So I think it was a real, you know, rebuff from all Security Council members. The Chinese and India has navigated very well, and by proclaiming that G70 is not going to change the status of line of control.
Yes.
And it is all India's internal affair.
Yes.
And once it is India's internal affair, you can have administrative changes according to the requirements of the time.
Hmm.
So I think all United Nations Security Council members were satisfied with this version of India.
Yes.
And you know, that even before UN Security Council members were sitting,
yes,
Imran Khan, the Pakistan's Prime Minister, talked to US President Donald Trump,
yes,
to get support and sympathy. But Donald Trump told very clearly that solve it bilaterally. So I think yesterday Pakistan and China got a test of time.
Yes.
By intruding in a terrain that was not expected.
All right.
Victoria.
Thank you so much, Akhilesh, for all those updates there. Meanwhile, the Jammu and Kashmir administration today restored a 2G mobile internet services in Jammu and Kashmir after days of restriction following the abrogation of Article 370. 2G mobile internet services have been restored in Jammu, Rasi, Samba, Kathua and Udhampur. However, restrictions under Section 144 will remain in force in Rajouri. And DM Rajouri said that telecom connectivity will gradually be eased and restored in a phased manner. 12 districts in Jammu and Kashmir out of 22 were functioning normally, while there was a limited nighttime restrictions only in 5 districts as precautionary measures. Jammu and Kashmir Chief Secretary B. Subramaniam said on Friday that schools and colleges in Kashmir will reopen from Monday. And addressing a press conference, he also said that there has been no loss of life or major injury since the restrictions were imposed on 5th of August.
Steps were taken that there was no shortage of essential supplies. Medical facilities and hospitals continued to function. Electricity, water supply, and sanitation services are maintained. Pilgrims going on Hajj and returning from Hajj were specifically facilitated, and people associated with providing all these services have free movement. Periodically, there were relaxations in some of these restrictions to enable people to come out for their daily requirements. 12 of the 22 districts are functioning normally with some limited restrictions in 5 of these. The measures put in place have ensured that there has been not a single loss of life. I repeat, there has not been a single loss of life or serious injuries to anyone during the course of maintaining peace and order. We have prevented any loss of human life despite concerted efforts by terrorist organizations, radical groups, and continuing efforts by Pakistan to destabilize the situation. Keeping in view the evolving situation, as well as the cooperation of the people in maintaining peace, we are now taking measures to ease the restrictions in a gradual, calibrated manner. After today's Friday prayers, which the immediate reports are has gone off quite peacefully right through the state, there would be an easing of restrictions in the next few days in an orderly way. Schools will be opened after the weekend, area-wise, so that children's studies do not suffer.
Meanwhile, Vice President M. Venkaiah Naidu said that the abrogation of Kashmir's special status is a major step towards ensuring an inclusive India. In a newspaper article, Venkaiah Naidu wrote, "A vast majority of people in the country feel that the abrogation is a welcome step." He added that it is being seen as a major step towards ensuring an inclusive India. Taking readers through history, the Vice President writes that in the past, instead of bringing people of Kashmir closer to the rest of India, Article 370 has only widened the chasm. He added that while Article 370 failed to benefit the people in a meaningful way, it was used by the separatists to drive a wedge between those living in Jammu and Kashmir and the rest of the country. It was also used by a neighboring country to spread terrorism. The Vice President reiterated that the abrogation of Article 370 is a national issue involving countries' safety, security, unity, and equitable prosperity. And the 9-day National Tribal Festival Adi Mahotsav will begin in Leh Ladakh from today. It will be inaugurated by Jammu and Kashmir Governor Satyapal Malik. The theme of the festival is a celebration of the spirit of tribal craft, culture and commerce. Tribal Affairs Ministry and Tribal Cooperative Marketing Development Federation of India are jointly organizing this festival. Around 160 tribal artisans from over 20 states and union territories will showcase their traditional arts and handicrafts in the 9-day festival. On to some other news. Prime Minister Narendra Modi embarked on a 2-day visit to Bhutan, during which the two strategic partners will aim to further strengthen their bilateral ties. The top leadership of both the countries will ink 10 MOUs. The Prime Minister's visit marks India's 5 decades of hydropower cooperation with Bhutan. Our correspondent Akhilesh Suman brings us more.
Prime Minister Narendra Modi will call on the Bhutanese King Jigme Khesar Namgyal Wangchuk and hold delegation-level talks with his counterpart Lotay Shering. Both sides will sign 10 new agreements and inaugurate 5 projects, including the rollout of the RuPay card scheme. Prime Ministers Modi and Shering will jointly inaugurate the ground earth station built by ISRO in Thimphu at a cost of about 7 crore rupees. The highlight of the visit will be the inauguration of the 720 megawatt Mangdechu hydropower project jointly developed by India and Bhutan. A power purchase agreement will also be signed during the visit.
Formal inauguration of the Mangdechu hydroelectric power project. 720 megawatts, 4 units, 3 of which have already been commissioned, at a cost of about 5,012 crores. It is actually the most cost-effective hydro project in South Asia. It's on 70% loan and 30% grant. And we will also be signing the Mangdechu Hydroelectric Power Project Power Purchase Agreement.
Both countries will make efforts to increase collaboration in STEM learning that comprises science, technology, engineering and maths, besides exploring collaboration in new sectors like healthcare. Modi will also address students of the Royal University of Bhutan on Sunday. India is also providing 400 crore rupees for a trade support facility to encourage Bhutanese exporters.
This is a special package that we intend to give Bhutan to encourage Bhutanese exporters to export more to India, because our objective is to diversify the relationship from simply being based on hydropower cooperation to other areas where we want to cooperate or collaborate with Bhutan. So this is a special focus and a special package being given in this 5-year plan only as trade support for companies and producers and manufacturers to incentivize them to export more to India.
In a statement ahead of his departure, the Prime Minister said his visit to Bhutan reflects the importance that the government attaches to India's relations with its trusted friend and neighbour. The Prime Minister added that both countries enjoy excellent bilateral ties, exemplified by extensive development partnership, mutually beneficial hydropower cooperation, and strong trade and economic linkages.
Prime Minister Narendra Modi is going to Bhutan at a time when there is a lot of churning in regional politics, and Indo-Pacific politics is taking the center stage. it will be interesting to see that how far Bhutan can be accommodated and how Bhutan's importance and contribution can be got in Indo-Pacific region. Akhilesh Suman for Raj Sabha Television in Delhi.
And with a view to solidify India's relationship with the Baltic nations, Vice President M. Venkaiah Naidu will embark on a 6-day visit to Lithuania, Latvia and Estonia. The major focus of the visit will be to advance India's outreach to the three Baltic nations that were once part of the erstwhile Soviet Union and are now independent nations. Vice President Naidu will be in Lithuania from 17th to 19th of August, Latvia on 19th and 20th of August, and in Estonia on the 20th and 21st of August. Efforts will be made to strengthen strategic ties with agreements related to technology likely to be signed. These countries are important for India's strategic agenda, and ties with them affect our friendship with the European nations positively. The Vice President will also unveil a bust of Mahatma Gandhi in Latvia and will also meet the Indians living in all the three countries. He will also address business forum meets.
India and Baltic countries have a historical connect, and it is generally accepted that there are common linguistic roots, notwithstanding the distance. This is sensed a lot in the Baltic countries. They feel that with Sanskrit and other aspects of Indian culture, there is a kind of closeness which need to be nurtured and taken forward. The cutting-edge technology and innovation ecosystems of the Baltic countries also complement India's huge market and appetite for these kind of technologies. They are supportive of this India's claim to a permanent membership of UNSC. On terrorism also, I think they have been very, very understanding, and post-Pulwama also they have been extremely responsive. So I think there is very common ground with these countries. But you're also aware that they're a part of the larger European space as well. So when we work with these countries, we also get the opportunity to work with these friends as, you know, within the European space.
And Vice President M. Venkaiah Naidu on Friday unveiled former Prime Minister late Atal Bihari Vajpayee's portrait at the Rabindra Tagore Center in Kolkata. Describing him as a statesman and a visionary, Venkaiah Naidu said that Vajpayee taught everybody to serve the country selflessly and to remain steadfastly committed to the principles of humanism and tolerance.
Atalji was a role model, an astute parliamentarian, an administrator for excellence, a visionary statesman, an erudite scholar, a gifted orator, most beloved leader, above all a great human being who believed in the core Indian values of harmony and synthesis. Atalji brought systematic changes in the governance of the country through technology innovation and research to improve the lives of the people. He brought the connectivity revolution, which paved the way for development and growth. Providing a responsive administration to the people, especially to the most vulnerable sections of society, was central to Vajpayee's administration. He implemented reforms agenda and delivered good governance to the nation and administer great challenges.
And also in a related development, the Ram Manohar Lohia Hospital has been renamed after the late Prime Minister. It will now be called the Atal Bihari Vajpayee Institute of Medical Sciences.
जो आपकी professional social responsibility है, उसको गहराई और गंभीरता के साथ महसूस करके अटल जी के और नरेंद्र मोदी जी के सपनों का भारत बनाने में कंट्रीब्यूट करें. मुझे लगता है कि आज का जो कार्यक्रम है उसमें अपने जीवन के लिए इसी तरह का कोई एक नया सपना पालकर यहाँ से जाने का और उसी सपने को साकार करने के लिए नई ऊर्जा के साथ नया संकल्प लेकर जाने की आवश्यकता है.
And a Kavi Sammelan was also organized in the national capital to mark Vajpayee's first death anniversary. Many well-known people from the political and cultural fraternity of our country were present at the occasion.
I पूछने का प्रयास करता हूँ। अटल जी हमारे अटल ही रहेंगे।
मोदी सदा बनकर उसी मोदी को मन से बांच
है। कश्मीर की बात तो छोड़ दो मियां, पाकिस्तान हमारा है। कश्मीर की बात तो छोड़ दो मियां, पाकिस्तान हमारा है। ये पंक्तियां मैं पिछले एक साल से गा रहा था और एक और चार पंक्तियां। कश्मीर की बात तो छोड़ दो मियां, पाकिस्तान हमारा है।
पाकिस्तान
चुके हैं सागरों में, जल नहीं है दिन करो से।
Situation on the flood affected states. Well, the death toll in five flood affected states rose to 241 on Friday, with seven more deaths reported from Kerala as the flood waters receded from several parts of the worst hit state. Meanwhile, five casualties were reported from Rajasthan. So far, 111 people have died in rain-related incidents in Kerala, 70 in Madhya Pradesh, 54 in Maharashtra, 5 in Rajasthan and 1 in Andhra Pradesh. The Met Department has issued a red alert warning for Jodhpur, Nagaur and Pali in Rajasthan for the next 24 hours. The army has been asked to be vigilant. And over 4,000 people have been moved to relief camps in Guntur and Krishna districts of Andhra Pradesh as the Krishna River is in spate, causing floods and affecting normal life. The weather has improved in flood-hit western Maharashtra and Madhya Pradesh, allowing the authorities to speed up rescue and relief operations. Meanwhile, the Met Department has issued a red weather warning for several districts in Himachal Pradesh and an orange warning for extremely heavy rainfall in the entire state over the weekend. Meanwhile, light rains in the national capital brought some relief for Delhiites from the humid weather. The weatherman has forecast a generally cloudy sky with the possibility of light to moderate rain and strong surface winds during the day today as well. And the death toll rose in Kerala to 111, with the rescue teams recovering more bodies from the landslide ravaged Malappuram and Wayanad districts. So these two districts are the worst hit in the second spell of rains since 8th of August. Chief Minister Pinarayi Vijayan said that 31 persons are still missing and over 1.47 lakh are in 891 relief camps across the state. And according to the IMD Bulletin, a moderate rainfall with the wind speeds reaching 35 to 45 kilometers per hour is very likely to occur at one or two places in Malappuram, Idukki, Ernakulam, Thrissur and Palakkad districts. Sports news now. Asian and Commonwealth Games gold medalist wrestler Bajrang Punia has been nominated for the Rajiv Gandhi Khel Ratna Award. Punia's name for the country's highest sporting honour was unanimously finalised by a 12-member selection committee. Bajrang had last year won the gold medal in the 65-kilogram freestyle event at the Asian Games held in Jakarta. He had also won the gold medal in the same category at the Gold Coast Commonwealth Games. And with that, we wrap up this edition of Breakfast News. Thanks for watching. Have a great day ahead.